Hey guys, this is David Kwan here. So, long time ago, or I feel like it was a long time ago, maybe like a year ago, I purchased, you know, A Universe from Nothing, written by Loris M. Krauss, and The Afterword by Richard Dawkins. I bought this book on the iLibrary, and I was reading it through my iPad and iPhone from time to time. It took me a long time to kind of get through it, but last week I finally finished reading it. And so I want to make a video, another video, not this one, where I talk about this book. But before I get to that, I kind of just want to read the preface to this book, because I think everything that Loris Krauss really wants to kind of point out, like the points that he wants to make with this book, is in the preface. All the elaborate details are in the rest of the book, you know, and his passion for science and physics is particularly salient in the whole book. But I think the preface is where he really wants to make his point now, and this is where Loris Krauss is kind of like a philosopher more than a scientist in here. But I want to read this because I thought it was a very powerful way to begin the book. So he begins the preface with a quote from Jacob Bronowski. I'm not going to read it, but I'll just read the whole preface itself. In the interest of full disclosure, right at the outset, I must admit that I'm not sympathetic to the conviction that creation requires a creator, which is at the basis of all of the world's religions. Every day, beautiful and miraculous objects suddenly appear, from snowflakes in a cold winter morning to vibrant rainbows after a late afternoon summer shower. Yet no one but the most ardent fundamentalist would suggest that each and every such object is lovingly and painstakingly, and most important, purposefully created by a divine intelligence. In fact, many lay people as well as scientists revel in their ability to explain how snowflakes and rainbows can spontaneously appear based on simple, elegant laws of physics. Of course, one can ask, and many do, where do the laws of physics come from, as well as more suggestively, who created these laws? Even if one can answer the first query, the petitioner will then often ask, but where did that come from, or who created that, and so on. Ultimately, many thoughtful people are driven to the apparent need for first cause, as Plato, Aquinas, or the modern Roman Catholic Church might put it, and thereby to suppose some divine being, a creator of all there is, and all that there ever will be, someone or something eternal and everywhere. Nevertheless, the declaration of a first cause still leaves open the question, who created the creator? After all, what is the difference between arguing in favor of an eternally existing creator versus an eternally existing universe without one? These arguments always remind me of the famous story of an expert giving a lecture on the origins of the universe, sometimes identified as Bernard Russell and sometimes William James, who is challenged by a woman who believes that the world is held up by a gigantic turtle, who is then held up by another turtle, and then another, with further turtles all the way down. An infinite regress of some creative force that begets itself, even some imagined force that is greater than turtles, doesn't get us any closer to what it is that gives rise to the universe. Nonetheless, this metaphor of an infinite regression may actually be closer to the real process by which the universe came to be than a single creator would explain. Defining away the question by arguing that the buck stops with God may seem to obviate the issue of infinite regression, but here I invoke my mantra. The universe is the way it is, whether we like it or not. The existence or non-existence of a creator is independent of our desires. A world without God or purpose may seem harsh or pointless, but that alone doesn't require God to actually exist. Similarly, our minds may not be able to easily comprehend infinites, although the mathematics, a product of our minds, deals with them rather nicely. But that doesn't tell us that infinities don't exist. Our universe could be infinite in spatial or temporal extent, or as Richard Feynman once put it, the laws of physics could be like an infinitely layered onion, with new laws becoming operational as we probe new scales. We simply don't know. For more than 2,000 years, the question, why is there something rather than nothing, has been presented as a challenge to the proposition that our universe, which contains a vast complex of stars, galaxies, humans, and who knows what else, might have arisen without design, intent, or purpose. While this is usually framed as a philosophical or religious question, it is first and foremost a question about the natural world. And so, the appropriate place to try and resolve it, first and foremost, is with science. The purpose of this book is simple. I want to show how modern science, in various guises, can address and is addressing the question of why there is something rather than nothing. The answers that have been obtained from staggeringly beautiful experimental observations, as well as from the theories that underlie much of modern physics, all suggest that getting something from nothing is not a problem. Indeed, something from nothing may have been required for the universe to come into being. Moreover, all signs suggest that this is how our universe could have arisen. I stress the word could here, because we may never have enough empirical information to resolve this question unambiguously. But the fact that a universe from nothing is even plausible is certainly significant, at least to me. Before going further, I want to devote a few words to the notion of nothing, a topic that I will return to at some length later. For I have learned that when discussing this question in public forums, nothing upsets the philosophers and theologians who disagree with me more than the notion that I, as a scientist, do not truly understand nothing. I am tempted to retort here that theologians are experts at nothing. Nothing, they insist, is not any of the things I discuss. Nothing is non-being in some vague and ill-defined sense. This reminds me of my own efforts to define intelligent design when I first began debating with creationists, of which it became clear there is no clear definition except to say what it isn't. Intelligent design is simply a unifying umbrella for opposing evolution. Similarly, some philosophers and many theologians define and redefine nothing as not being any of the versions of nothing that scientists currently describe. I know that gets a little complicated. The word nothing gets really complicated in this book, but I really like how he kind of addresses it here. Anyway, continuing on with the preface. But therein, in my opinion, lies the intellectual bankruptcy of much of theology and some of modern philosophy. For surely, nothing is every bit as physical as something, especially if it is to be defined as the absence of something. If it then behooves us to understand precisely the physical nature of both these quantities. And without science, any definition is just words. A century ago, had one described nothing as referring to purely empty space, pressing no real material entity, this might have received little argument. But the results of past century have taught us that empty space is in fact far from the inviolate nothingness that we presupposed before we learned more about how nature works. Now, I am told by religious critics that I cannot refer to empty space as nothing, but rather as quantum vacuum, to distinguish it from the philosophers or theologians' idealized nothing. So be it. But what if we are then willing to describe nothing as the absence of space and time itself? Is this sufficient? Again, I suspect it would have been at one time. But as I shall describe, we have learned that space and time can themselves spontaneously appear, so now we are told that even this nothing is not really the nothing that matters. And we're told that it's the escape from the real nothing requires divinity, with nothing thus divine by fiat to be that from which only God can create something. It has also been suggested by various individuals with whom I have debated the issue that if there is the potential to create something, then that is not a state of true nothingness. And surely having laws of nature that give such potential takes away from the true realm of non-being. But then if I argue that perhaps the laws themselves also arose spontaneously, as I shall describe might be the case, then that too is not good enough, because whatever system in which the laws may have arisen is not true nothingness. Turtles all the way down? I don't believe so, but the turtles are appealing because science is changing the playing field in ways that make people feel uncomfortable. Of course, that is one of the purposes of science. One might have said natural philosophy in Socratic terms. Lack of comfort means we are on the threshold of new insights. Surely, invoking God to avoid difficult questions of how is merely intellectually lazy. After all, if there were no potential for creation, then God couldn't have created anything. It would be scientific hocus-pocus to assert that potentially infinite regression is avoided because God exists outside nature, and therefore the potential for existence itself is not a part of the nothingness from which existence arose. My real purpose here is to demonstrate that in fact science has changed the playing field, so that these abstract and useless debates about the nature of nothingness have been replaced by useful operational efforts to describe how a universe may actually have originated. I will also explain the possible implications of this for our present and future. This reflects a very important fact. When it comes to understanding how our universe evolves, religion and theology have been at best irrelevant. They often muddy the waters, for example, by focusing on questions of nothingness without providing any definition of the term based on empirical evidence. While we do not yet fully understand the origin of our universe, There's no reason to expect things to change in this regard. Moreover, I expect that ultimately the same will be true for our understanding of areas a religion now considers its own territory, such as human morality. Science has been affected by furthering our understanding of nature because the scientific ethos is based on three key principles. 1. Follow the evidence wherever it leads. 2. If one has a theory, one needs to be willing to try to prove it wrong as much as one tries to prove that it is right. 3. The ultimate arbiter of truth is experiment, not the comfort one derives from one's a priori beliefs, nor the beauty or elegance one ascribes to one's theoretical models. The results of experiments that I will describe here are not only timely, they are also unexpected. The tapestry that science weaves in describing the evolution of our universe is far richer and far more fascinating than any revelatory images or imaginative stories that humans have concocted. Nature comes up with surprises that far exceed those that the human imaginations can generate. Over the past 2 decades, an exciting series of development in cosmology, particle theory, and gravitation have completely changed the way we view the universe, with startling and profound implications for our understanding of its origins as well as its future. Nothing could therefore not be more interesting to write about, if you can forgive the pun. The true inspirations for this book comes not so much from a desire to dispel myth or attack beliefs, as from my desire to celebrate knowledge and along with it, the absolutely surprising and fascinating universe that ours has turned out to be. Our search will take us on a whirlwind tour to the farthest reaches of our expanding universe, from the earliest moments of the Big Bang to the far future, and will include perhaps the most surprising discovery in physics and in the past century. Indeed, the immediate motivation for writing this book now is a profound discovery about the universe that has driven my own scientific research for most of the past 3 decades, and that resulted in the startling conclusion that most of the energy in the universe resides in some mysterious, now inexplicable, form permeating all of empty space. It is not an understatement to say that this discovery has changed the playing field of modern cosmology. For one thing, this discovery has produced remarkable new support for the idea that our universe arose from precisely nothing. It has also provoked us to rethink both the host of assumptions about the processes that might govern its evolution, and ultimately, the question of whether the very laws of nature are truly fundamental. Each of these, in its own turn, now tends to make the question of why there is something rather than nothing appear less imposing, if not completely facile, as I hope to describe. The direct genesis of this book harkens back to October of 2009, when I delivered a lecture in Los Angeles with the same title. Much to my surprise, a YouTube video of the lecture made available by Richard Dawkins Foundation has since become something of a sensation, with nearly a million viewings as of this writing, and numerous copies of parts of it being used by both the atheist and theist communities in their debates. Because of the clear interest in the subject, and also as a result of some of the confusing commentary on the web and in various media following my lecture, I thought it worth producing a more complete rendition of the ideas that I had expressed there in this book. Here, I can also take the opportunity to add to the arguments I presented at the time, which focused almost completely on the recent revolutions in cosmology that had changed our picture of the universe, associated with the discovery of the energy and geometry of space, and which I discussed in the first 2/3 of this book. In the intervening period, I thought a lot more about the many antecedents and ideas constituting my argument. I've discussed it with others who reacted with the kind of enthusiasm that was infectious, and I've explored more that the impact of developments in particle physics in particular on the issue of the origin and nature of our universe. And finally, I've exposed some of my arguments to those who vehemently opposed them, and in so doing have gained some insights that have helped me develop my arguments further. While fleshing out the ideas I've ultimately tried to describe here, I benefited tremendously from discussing with some of my most thoughtful physics colleagues. In particular, I want to thank Alan Gut and Frank blah, blah, blah. He thanks a bunch of people. And that's pretty much the preface. Lots in there. I think the interesting thing he really wants to point out is, you know, the word nothing. And that's kind of what the opponents of Lawrence Krauss have been pointing out. What you're saying is not really nothing. Your nothing is still something, is what the theologians and religious people have been wanting to point out. I think Lawrence Krauss makes a really strong case in the preface and in the book itself that, you know, you can really define nothing to mean what you want it to be, but scientifically speaking, nothing is the absence of something, and that something that we know is everything in the universe and time and space. you take away all that, isn't that nothing? And so the nature of nothing that's been scientifically studied shows that something can definitely arise of nothing, and that is really the point of this book, that the universe arose from nothing. And nothing, it also includes no physical laws. You know, there are laws of physics and natural laws that are in play, you know, such as Newton's law of gravity or law of motion and things like that. There are laws that are affecting this natural world. Well, what if there were no laws? You know, then how did they come about? Did someone have to create them in order for that to be law? Not necessarily. And that's like the powerful notion of this book, that the state of nothingness is more volatile and more chaotic than we assume nothing to be, which I think is a very fascinating aspect. And I'll talk more about like my thoughts on the book as a whole. I just wanted to read the preface because I thought it was a lot of very powerful stuff gets mentioned in the preface, and I just wanted to kind of read it aloud. You know, if you guys are at all interested in this kind of stuff, definitely check Lawrence Krauss's book out. Although it's hard read. It is a very difficult read, I think, it was certainly difficult for me because I'm not a very good at physics, not a very science-ish person. I've always been more interested in history and sociology and things like that. But even I got a good kick out of this book. So definitely, I'll end it here. And in the next video, I will talk more about the book itself.